All right, I'm going to give you a handout in just a couple minutes, just as a kind of a prelude, for lack of better words, to that. I think I've already shown you this, but just if you forget or don't care, yes, do care. If you do get into YouTube and just type in Jeff Scott hyphen Rankin Technical College, that will actually bring you to my channel. Now, there's more like 2,000 lectures in there. It's not 1,200. That's old. I don't know why it doesn't update. But if you go out there and you do that, one of the ones that you'll find under playlists is the playlist for this class. All right, Spring 2020 AWD1100 C# Programming. And again, you'll see if you do that, that there are already, I don't know why I did that, but there are already about 75 lectures out there. All right. And I know I don't want to play any of them, but there you go, view full playlist. That's what I wanted. And including from yesterday, what happened was when I did the welcome between 8 and 9, for some reason, it didn't record. And that happens once in a while. It could be that I didn't turn it on, but I'm pretty sure I did. Sometimes it just doesn't record. So I redid that this morning in about 20 minutes. This is when we went over Chapter 1 yesterday. All right. Now, you probably have heard this kind of thing before, but I'm just going to say it to you anyway. We have 2 years. Okay, we don't have, we're not a baccalaureate school, although you can get a bachelor hit baccalaureate degree here and a couple different things. But the point is, I know that when I got my four-year degree, I had to take a lot of classes that they weren't fluff, but they were history of this and history of that, and et cetera. There weren't that many classes where we actually did stuff. This is going to be a class where you do stuff. If I have my way, we'll see how much of this we get done. We're going to do 10 programs today. All right? And, I mean, that's the only way for you to learn this stuff. All right? And now you might hear that and go, my God, we'll never get that done. Well, we're going to do 2 console programs, and then with the 8 that are left, we'll do one program, and then we'll do it, you know, as a console, then do the same program as a GUI. Then again. And I'm going to walk you through stuff. You're not turning this in. I want you to start to get, hopefully, a comfort level with this stuff. All right? That's the idea behind it. Now, we won't do this until 11:55, but somewhere 10:30, quarter to 11, 11-ish, etc., we'll go over Chapter 2. All right? And then tomorrow, we're going to go over Chapter 3, and I'll probably give you a few more programs to work on. All right? That'll be Wednesday. And then what I'll do tomorrow is I'm just going to ask people, you know, where do you stand? How comfortable do you feel with this stuff? Now, yesterday in my afternoon class, now, they're second-year people. They're in their fourth semester, so they're different than you are in a lot of ways. But we wrote, and I'm not exaggerating, probably about 500 lines of code. We did 3.5 programs, and I looked up, and it was 3:45, so we had about 45 minutes left. And these people just looked drained. I mean, we could have finished the program in the time that was left. I said, let's just stop it right here. And we'll finish it up tomorrow, and we'll go on tomorrow. The point is, this is what we're going to be doing a lot of in here. Because I don't believe you're going to learn a lot from me lecturing. I believe you're going to learn some from us doing programs together. But you're going to learn the most when you do your own programs. You're going to fail. You're going to make some mistakes. That's to be expected. There's going to be something that comes up, and you're going to be like, I never had an error like this. We never had an error like this in class. Raise your hand. Again, Mai had asked about this, and Luke, the tutor, I've invited him in Thursday and or Friday. He's just going to see. He also works, so he's got to, you know, work it into his schedule and stuff, and plus, he's engaged. I think he's getting married in September. He's trying to get all this stuff together. All right? So, you know, it's a lot of stuff to go through. You know, and it's interesting because I just found out when I was in St. Louis last week that my counterpart teaching this class in St. Louis, Evan, he got married last May. He's going to be a dad in June. He's actually trying to set up his schedule so he can literally take off all summer. You know, so stuff happens, and stuff's going to happen with you. Some of this stuff is going to make total sense. You're going to go, oh, this is very much like what we did before, and boom, 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 you'll get right to it. And something is going to trip you up somewhere along the way where you're like, I know this is probably a simple question, but, you know, and I've said this kind of thing before. I don't know if I've ever said it to you two last semester, but when somebody raises their hand and says, you know, I know this is a really dumb question, but all of a sudden everyone starts listening because they want to hear what a dumb question sounds like. They really do. And literally 10 times out of 10, it's not a dumb question. In fact, a lot of times everybody else has the same question, but for whatever reason, they're afraid to ask it. Now, if you really feel like something is dumb, then just come up and ask me or ask Luke when he's here. I know Maya will tell you because she worked with Luke a little bit at the end of the semester. He's not at all intimidating, and you can talk to him. Sometimes people will talk to a tutor because they're a fellow student, and they'll ask stuff they wouldn't ask me. Because like I said, they figure, well, he's going to just think I'm dumb. I don't think any of you are dumb. I don't think any of the people who are going to graduate are dumb. All right? Some of you are going to get some of this stuff or much of this stuff or all of this stuff faster than others will. Doesn't matter. You know, what's the old saying? You know, I hate to sound like just all these trite expressions, but, you know, it's a marathon, not a sprint. But it is. And in this case, it's a two-year marathon. You know? And I don't think that, you know, I don't think you two, after you finish this class, will say, okay, I want a job in this field, and I don't want to be a web developer, but I do want to be a C-sharp programmer, or vice versa. And I don't think, you know, that you three will be able to say, I want to be a C-sharp programmer. That's what I'm getting out of this program. You haven't had enough experience yet. All right? Believe it or not, you know, I'm 63, and I don't know how many more years I'm going to work. I really don't. If my wife has her way, it'll be till I drop dead over here sometime. You know, and she likes it because I've got all my pensions and stuff are all set up that they all go to her anyway. So, but she said, no, I'd like you to work at least 5 more years. And I said, why? She said, if you were here right now, she said, I'd just kill you. You know, so maybe I will. Maybe I'll work more than that. Maybe I'll work less than that. I don't know. But the point is, regardless of how long I work, I'm already planning what I'm going to do because I'm not going to retire. All right, I'm going to be doing something, and it's going to be in this field. All right, probably I'm just going to have my own website, and what I'll do is the same kind of stuff I'm doing now, but I'll teach people, you know, programming in different languages, and I'm not even going to charge. I'll put it out there because I know other people who do that. All right, and why am I going to do that? Just because, some people look at it that the day you retire, you start to live. Some people look at it as the day you retire, you start to die. And unfortunately, I think with my father, he was a chemical engineer, and he got kicked out because he was 65. I think he started to die. Now, he lived until he was 88, but I don't ever remember him being very happy after he retired. I remember him eating a lot, more than anything else. And the funny thing is, when he worked, when we were kids, he never ate hardly anything. And he never watched TV, but when he retired, well, he could tell you everything on every Walker, Texas Ranger episode there ever was. All right? So, you know, again, we'll see. So all I'm saying is if it doesn't come to you like that, don't let it bother you, please. But if it's 2 months from now, and even if you're getting it, if you're getting a C or a B or whatever, but you think I'm really not getting this, whenever you're comfortable, then talk to me. And if you're not, send me an email. All right, come in here early. You know, again, I am here at 5:30, if not every morning, at least 4 out of 5. All right? Okay, so the other thing I want to tell you about that, too, is one of the first classes that I ever taught. I was at a technical college way up in northern Wisconsin. And the first day of class, I was told, well, you got to teach night students a little differently. This is what I was told by my boss. I said, like what? Well, you got 17 people in here. Go around the room, have them introduce themselves, and say why they're taking the class. And I thought, well, that's stupid. But that's what he wanted, so I did it. Okay, so I got to the end, and there were two guys there. It was pretty obvious they knew one another. So they said their names, and I said, well, why are you taking the class? And the first guy said, let me ask you a question. How many programs are we going to be assigned in this class? I said, well, it won't be easy. I'm actually going to assign 17 programs. You know, and they'll go from fairly simple to really complex. And they were both like, yes! And I was like, what? And they had been students at the University of Wisconsin, Stevens Point. They had taken a beginning C programming class. That's what I was teaching. They did 2 programs in 16 weeks. And one of them was to write hello on the screen. And the other one, they did, it was more complex, of course, but they did most of it as a class. I said, what did you do? Oh, I can tell you anything about the history of the language. And we don't do that here. We, you know, if you care about it, you can go look it up online. All right? But you're never going to get a question here that's going to be historical in nature. There's no reason for it. Now, you might be asked, how do you do this? How do you do that? All right? So let me pass this out, and I will go over it with everybody. And again, you're not turning this in. Please don't look at this and go, I can never do this. But I will tell you the truth. I probably shouldn't say this on a tape, but I will anyway, that the book we used to use for this class is right here. It's not a bad book. From a different publisher, different author. So why did we change? The book that we're using now is got so much more information in it. But that book had some really good exercises. So I'm not going to lie, I'm pilfering some of the exercises. Maybe doing a little bit of rewrite, etc. And that's what some of these are. So I have not written one of these programs. We're going to write them together. Or at least most of them we're going to write together. And will we have problems? Let's see as we get going. All right, but let's go over what these are about. So, and again, you did a good job yesterday telling me when, you know, if I tap this. I realized yesterday part of the problem was I had a flash drive in here. When I have a flash drive in here and I touch the flash drive, it seems to do a lot of that. So hopefully that won't happen as much today. We'll see. All right, so the first one, we're going to make a console program called Stop Sign Console, where we're going to create this. Now, that doesn't look hard. Well, what is it? Literally, there's no inputs, and that's our output. So we're going to do a bunch of write line statements where we're going to write like a line of X's, then an X and maybe some tabs, and another X, an X, a tab, the word stop, a tab. You get the idea, right? All right. And you're like, well, why are we doing that? Just to get used to, you know, just to get our feet firmly planted, do something that really isn't that hard. All right. Then after that, we're going to create one that's called, this is my takeoff on this. It's called My First Initial Console. Now, you might not like that, but that's a J. Does that really look like a J? You don't like it. If yours is J, then do your own. All right. Now, with that one, what we're going to do is I'm going to give you about 15 minutes. I'm going to ask you to try to do that one yourself. And then I'll show you, while you're doing that, I'll do the J. And then I'll show you what I did. Okay? Then we're going to go, and these are kind of standard types of things. We'll create a console that's called inches to centimeters. And basically what we'll do is we'll also be introduced to what's called a constant. That's a value that cannot change while the program's running. All right? And we'll put that in there, and then we'll ask somebody, all right, how many inches? And we can come up with numbers, you know, whatever we want. And, for instance, if we put in 3, it should display on the screen 3 inches is 7.62 centimeters. If you don't like that, you can say 3 inches equals 7.62. Doesn't matter. Then we'll go back and we'll rewrite this as a GUI. And what that'll do is it'll allow us to go in and start thinking about how to design a form. How, you know, what you should think about when you're doing it. All right, probably for your first test that you, again, I think I told you this, so you probably have maybe 2 programs. One will be console, one will be a GUI. And I'll probably do screenshots of each one to show you what I'm looking for. As long as it looks somewhat like that, I don't want it ever where people get so stuck on, oh my God, it's not like his, I'm off by a couple spaces and it just won't. No, don't do that. It's the idea. That's what I'm looking for. All right. So we'll do that, and then if you turn it over, we got a couple, and these are pretty much almost the same kind of program. I mentioned yesterday that one of the reasons that we could use modulo, our remainder operator, is to get remainders. All right. So for instance, if I said 86,400, what is that? That's the number of seconds that are in a day. But if we give some kind of a number, like 6420, it should say 3 hours, 17 minutes, 0 seconds, something like that. So we'll do that in a console format. Then we'll go back and do it again in a GUI format. By doing this, other than those first 2, all right, so numbers 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10, you'll be seeing that you're using the same logic in both cases. In one case, we have no GUI. That's what a console is. And, you know, I've had people in the past say, why don't you just, pardon my French, just screw console. Don't even do it. Everybody does GUI anyway. When we get to Chapter 12, we will be working on object-oriented programming. When you work with object-oriented programming, you work with things called classes. Don't worry about what they are. They're blueprints, for lack of better words. But guess what? They're classes that get written like console programs. They have no GUI. So this will, you know, it'll be, give us a chance basically to go back to that, because we have kind of a place to start from, for lack of better words. All right, so we'll do again this hours, minutes, and seconds. And then we'll do it again, kind of like the thing with making change. And I didn't really probably put it on here. I literally wrote this about 10 minutes before you got in here. So, for instance, if I put 633 there, what's the maximum number of quarters? Well, 25 quarters, if I did my math right, that would be, in fact, now that I look at it, that's the wrong calculation. 25 quarters would have been $6.25. I don't know where I got the dimes from. So that really should be 0 dimes, 0 nickels, and 8 pennies. Does that make sense? All right, other than the fact I did the math wrong. All right. So that kind of thing. Then we'll go back and we'll rewrite it as a GUI. All right. And then finally we'll do, again, this is kind of standard, like a Fahrenheit to Celsius conversion program. What we'll do probably tomorrow to get you into Chapter 3 is when we write this as a console program, you'll put in a number that's a Fahrenheit number. You'll click a button. It'll give you the Celsius equivalent. But what would be kind of nice would be able to say, okay, give me a number. And then say, do you want to go from Fahrenheit to Celsius or Celsius to Fahrenheit? And do it that way. Now, you two might remember that because you did something similar to that last semester, but you did it in JavaScript. So you're going to be able to see the differences in how you would do something like that, and you would do it in C sharp. All right? So I'm asking, and if you don't, that's fine. Does everybody has a machine here, it looks like, right? Did you get a chance to download Visual Studio? All right, do you have Visual Studio on yours? Okay, well, if you don't, then we'll talk about how you can check and how you can access it right now. All right? So there are two different ways in here if you look on the screen. If you created an icon for it, it's right there. Kind of looks like a bow tie, for lack of better words, and it's purple. That is the Visual Studio 2019 icon. So if you have that on your taskbar, you can click that to start. You look up on the screen here. If you don't have that, you can come down here into your search box and just type in Visual. Notice it came up right away, Visual Studio 2019. Now, if you don't have it on your taskbar here and you want it, and you type in here Visual and it comes up, you can right mouse click and just say pin the taskbar, and that'll put it there. Sometimes some people like their start menu too, where you click that to get going. You can also set it to your start menu. This is your stuff. You set it up any way you want. I'm more concerned with once I click this, it's going to come up and run Visual Studio. So can everybody please at least attempt to bring up Visual Studio right now? And if you attempt to, and you have any problems, just raise your hand. Again, mine will look different than yours because you don't have programs on yours. So yours might look, you might only see like this or whatever. It's totally fine. Yes?
Do I want to allow this to happen?
Yes. That just says that when you may not have it loaded then, because when it did that, it took the executable file and it said, hey, I want to run it. And what you're saying is that's okay.
Oh.
All right. And there are times, depending on how your machine is set up, it didn't do it for you, and that's good. Mine doesn't either, but sometimes it'll say you have to log in as administrator or whatever. And I've had situations where students come in here and they want to load software, but it's their parents' machine. Then they need to maybe log in as their, well, I don't know my mom's login or my dad's, well, I don't know what to tell you then. Because you may not have the ability to actually install some software. They may only have that. Well, what do I do? Well, here's an idea. Get your own machine. You know, and I'm not trying to be a smart aleck. I'm just saying you probably would want your own machine anyway. Okay? All right. Now, and if yours is still loading, don't worry about it because I'm not doing this fast. Okay. Other than Chris here, do the rest of you have something that looks like this? Okay, yeah, yours is still only partially done too. That's fine. What Dominic has here, you probably the rest of you only went through that. That's the visual studio installer. So it's asking, what do you want to install through here? All right, and you want... You want the .NET, you want that one right there. I would do it this way, I don't think you're going to use that. And you can just arrow down and see it, or come on down and see if there's anything else here. I don't think there's anything else you can do. Now, if, for example, oh no, I want to do games, Jeff. Well, yeah, you can choose games. You know what I'm saying? But we're not going to really be, any games that we create here, we might create one or two. They're going to be more like console games or simplistic games. You don't, what they expect in here is if you choose games, then you want to use Unity. And you could do Unity and learn C sharp that way too. I've already suggested that. That didn't meet with a lot of good results from the people that I work with. All right. Go back up. Did you click it? That's okay. If you started it up, that's okay. All right. And that'll take a bit.
What was Unity?
That you, so you're exactly what Dominic was. So. If you would, take your cursor, put it up here and break down with it. You want, I said you might want that one right there. And, I'll put that up, let's see. The .NET. That, I think that's going to be enough. Now, if it ever turns out that, oh man, I really wish I would have loaded this and I didn't, okay? What you can always do after you start doing that, I think you got that on the bottom of the video to start it. You can always go back and bring up the Visual Studio installer, and you can always add things or remove things if you want to. Microsoft has done a pretty good job, and I'm not a real big, oh God, do I love Microsoft. I'm not that guy. I'm more the other way. All right? But they have done a good job of setting this thing up. All right? So hopefully in just a couple minutes, you'll get here. But when, again, when it all comes up and you want to go and run this, this is the icon that you'll want. So you'll either tell it to put an icon there, or when it's all done, you will come into your search bar here. If you type in visual, you'll see that it'll come up. That's an old version. I don't know why that's there, but all right, so you'll have Visual Studio 2019. All right. One thing that I just want you to know this, okay? Because so I've had this happen where, oh my God, I did this. I didn't mean to. You can run more than one copy of this at the same time. So for instance, if you're working on one program and you want to copy some stuff to another program, as an example, you can have two different sessions or whatever you want to call them of Visual Studio 2019 up and running. It doesn't hurt anything. You can bounce back and forth between them. You know what I mean? That doesn't hurt anything. I've had as many as maybe a half dozen up at a time. Now, just so you know, I don't know any other way to say it than this. This package is kind of a pig, and what I mean is it's big. All right, but it's an IDE. Now, we may or may not have talked about that yesterday, but an IDE is an integrated development environment. And what that means is it's not, there's a product here that's called Visual Studio Code. These guys used it last semester. You'll use it in fall next year. All right, and it's used basically to allow you to type in the stuff you need for websites. Okay, and it's got a lot of stuff built into it. But on a scale of 1 to 10, If Visual Studio that we're using is a 10 as far as power goes, Visual Studio Code is about a 3.5. With an IDE like we have, it'll have things in it. You saw a little bit of it yesterday. I'm going to show you some more today. It has things like IntelliSense. What I mean is if you start typing something in, quite often you'll see a list of things. Oh, do you want to do one of these? Now, you don't have to do that, but if it's the one you want, you can hit Enter or Tab, and it'll put the code on screen for you. They also have a thing in there, we're not going to go over that today, that's called Snippets, that will actually put code in there for you. It's got stuff from libraries and stuff that are out there. It color codes things. It literally spell checks for you. All right? So it does a lot of stuff like that. And like I said, it's pretty powerful. All right? Now, I don't know where you guys are. Is it still, you know, you have... Okay. What is going to happen, the rest of you can do this. I'm not going to do it right now. But like we did yesterday, we're going to choose Create New Project. So that will be the next thing you do. I don't want to go on and do any more of that until these two are caught up. All right. I mean, this is a one-time shot. You should only have to do this install once. You know what I mean? So I think what I'll do is I'm at 26 minutes right now. Is on how to design a Windows Forms application. All right. So they've got some options you should set, and then how to design a form, naming, and saving of files. Now, one thing about, like, when they talk about things like naming, all right, I'm not real strict. This is the way I look at it. When I went to school and got my, I had a four-year degree. It was in journalism, all right, which basically went nowhere. So I went back and got a two-year degree, like you're doing. And I had a few different teachers, but one of the teachers I liked the most said, hey, develop your own style. You might as well do it now, because if you get hired at a place, you might not have any choice. And that's what happened to me. I got hired at AT&T Bell Laboratories. It was back in the 80s before they had their breakup. And we were told how to do things. So right now, start to develop your own style. All right? And we'll get into what all that stuff means in just a bit. All right. So how to set options and create a new project. Now, one thing that's in here, I already mentioned this to you yesterday, but they have here the options dialog. There's all sorts of things that you can set in here. For instance, by default, I believe you won't have line numbers on your editor. So you can go in and if you notice, one of these in here someplace will allow you to add line numbers. All right? There are standard colors that you're given in here. For example, one of the standard colors for comments is, you know, it's green. All right? It bugged the students a little yesterday. We're using a different IDE for Android, and the comments, instead of being in green, they're in gray. They didn't like that. That's just the way that it's set up. Normally, you can go in and actually change the colors if you want to. I mean, I would recommend not doing that. I think there's a thing in there for doing it later. Yeah, I would just do that. I have asked, just so you guys know, I don't know if he's going to come in here today or not, but I asked Mr. Corrigan to stop by if he gets a minute or two, just to introduce himself so you know who he is, etc. But going back to what you just asked, Chris, he typically is the one. He'll set up Microsoft accounts for everybody. You want to choose, I'm glad you asked, you want Visual C Sharp. All right? Because what that'll do is that'll make sure if you chose General, it'll bring up every single option when you start for every language that they have. But when you choose C Sharp, it'll only bring up the C Sharp stuff. All right? Okay. The import and export settings, you might remember that. I showed you that yesterday. As far as if you move stuff around on the screen and you want to move it back again, you can go to import and export settings and just tell it to basically reset the defaults. So creating a new project, this is what we're going to do in a minute. It doesn't look exactly like this. All right? And you might say, well, you know, then why do we got this old book? Because the new one that they have is coming out in March. And it didn't work. We can't do that. I'm not going to make you buy two books. All right? I'm not going to wait till March to use it. I talked with the publisher. I asked, could we get proof pages, etc.? And that's very important. One thing that just made me think of, just so you know, how many people don't have the book yet? And it's okay. All right. What they sent me yesterday was they sent me a PDF of Chapter 1. So I'm going to send that to all of you. Now, the other thing, just so you're aware of this, you can do this now, you can do it later, or not at all. But if you go out, it's a Muroc book, so if you go out to Muroc.com, all right, and you find the book, what do I mean find the book? Well, once this comes up, got way too much stuff open, that's why it's taking so long on here. All right, then you shop books, go down and find C-sharp programming books, okay? What you're going to see real soon, if they don't have it in here yet, is they're going to have their new book is going to be in here. But this is the one we have. So if you click on the picture of the book we have, come on, and you go down to where it says free downloads, look on the screen, you can download chapter 2 and 3 as a PDF. So my rep sent me a link, a PDF to chapter 1. She said it's much better for them to get it off of here for chapters 2 and 3. So you will have chapters, should have chapters 2 and 3 by the end of class. Otherwise, what I'll do is I'll just download all of them, just send you a link to all of them. All right? But again, the new project dialog box has changed a lot between 2015 and 2019. Okay. How to design a form. This is the form they have you design in here. Does everybody understand when you look at this? I'm asking this question. This, 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 and this, those are all labels. What we learned yesterday was when the program's running, you can't click on that, you can't change those labels. That's just how it works. This, 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 and this are all text boxes. All right? And typically, when you do this, they didn't do it here, but you would enter this, you would enter this, these two, even though they don't show it, they would probably be read-only. All right? I mean, it's like when you work with a calculator. I got a calculator and I type in 56 times 12 and it gives me the answer. I can't say I don't like that answer. I'm going to change it. All right? Because when you do that with a calculator, it's read-only. The answer is basically read-only.
That's the same thing here. And of course, as I mentioned here, this and this are buttons.
Now, one thing we really didn't talk about yesterday that we'll get into, but not in a lot of depth and breadth of coverage. For instance, a lot of people hate the fact that these buttons look so boxy. If you go into the properties, you could actually go in there and give them a lot more of a rounded look if you want to. I'm not going to go into that because that's, you know, that's aesthetic stuff. So we won't spend a lot of time on stuff like that, but you can if you want to. All right.
People ask me too, well, can I change it and have different kinds of colors? As long as I can read it and it's, you know, for lack of better words, it's not butt ugly.
You know, I've had people use color combinations that are like, you know, like a real hot pink and then yellow writing and stuff like that, where it's very hard to read. But if you want to do, you know, show your artistic side or whatever, I don't care. But again, labels are just that. Text boxes for inputting or outputting information. In fact, now that I look at it, that's the only one that's input. These three are all read-only. You can see that they're grayed. We'll do this. We'll take a break, and then we'll come back, and then hopefully everybody will be ready. How to add controls. If you remember, I showed you yesterday, there are at least three different ways to add controls to forms. Look on the screen, please, because I'm going to show you all three. We did yesterday. If I want a button, I can click on this button tool, hold down on my left mouse, and drag it out. Does that make sense? It'll work just fine. Now, if I want two buttons, I can bring out the first one like that. Then I can click on it, do a control C to copy, a control V, and it'll paste it someplace, then drag it down. The other way is you can take it where they have this here, just double click on there. So there's three different ways. Which one do you use? Whichever one you want. I could never tell the one you used, not to be funny, I don't care. And you saw this yesterday a little bit,
when you start to line stuff up, you'll get what are called guidelines. All right, sometimes they'll be blue, sometimes they'll be purple. So things, you know, line up like little soldiers and look nice. All right, what one thing you should be shooting for is a professional looking type of interface. What you'll find at the end of the semester, and again, we're not talking about that now, but when we were working on our electronic portfolios, you'll have copies of your work. All right. Now, you may hear this summer, hey, so-and-so is having, I heard they had, they're providing the opportunity for somebody to come in and basically do like an apprenticeship type of thing. All right. And internship is what I'm looking for. And, or the best way is, you know, for example, Keegan has told me that his dad, where is he works? It's at Enterprise. You know, and if he said to Keegan, yeah, you know, we could really use somebody to come in this summer and do some work as a C-sharp programmer. But they may say, do you have an example of your work? Well, you want to make sure that what you show them looks nice. All right, at least looks professional. When you do this, as it says, now you saw yesterday when we put those labels, I had to set that auto size to false. With these, like with text boxes, you can just text, click and drag on them and make them wider, narrower, etc. You can do that. Same thing with buttons. You can make them as big. You know, I could make them wider so they look chunky. Whatever you want to do, it doesn't really matter. We looked a little bit at properties yesterday. Anytime you click on something, in the properties window will be the property for that something. If you click on an empty spot on the form, it'll be the stuff for the form. You saw me do that yesterday. Now, what you can do, just so you know this, well, what if I wanted to make sure all my buttons were exactly the same size and they're not? You can draw one of those lassos where you hold down on the left mouse button and basically draw around them. And then what you're going to notice is this is going to change. Because instead of being the properties for just one control, they're now the properties for two controls. So it's only things that you can change in bulk, so to speak. And you're going to see all this as we start going through it. It's kind of nice because this gives me a chance to walk through a few things. Here are what they mentioned are some of the common properties. I want all of your controls to have a name. If you don't give them one, you get one by default. So in other words, by default, if you look on the screen here, that'll be, let's assume you put in this, then this, then this, then this, then this, then this, etc. This will be label 1, label 2, label 3, label 4, text box 1, text box 2, text box 3, button 1 and button 2. Those are not good names. The names should reflect what the text box or label or button are doing. That's my opinion. Now, Microsoft has changed over the years. For instance, if this is Calculate, for a while it was called Button Calculate. Then it was called Calculate Button. Then it was called BTN for Button Calculate. Now it's back again to Button Calculate. So I'll expect you to follow that. So your buttons will all start with the word button. Your labels will all start with the word label. Your text boxes will all start with the word text box. That makes sense? All right. And people always say, well, what if I don't do it? Are you going to take off? It's like, why tempt me? All right, so hopefully, you know, that's not going to be any kind of an issue. Sometimes when you bring up one of these things here, for instance, let's see, tap stop true. If I click on the word true, I'll get a down arrow like this. And then it'll show me true or false. But if there's just two options like that, I can also double click on it. And it'll go from true to false or false to true. All right. Some of these controls literally have up to 100 properties. Typically, you won't change more than 3 or 4. All right. Text property, we looked at that yesterday for the form and for the label. All right. And that's what it puts in. Here's some other ones I actually showed you yesterday. The accept button. I showed you the cancel button. I even showed you the start position where we put it on the center of the screen. So you've seen those. You can disable things by setting the enabled property to true. For instance, when a program comes up, maybe you don't want to allow the user to click the button until they put in some information. So you could set the enabled property on the button, you could set it to false. And then once they put in information, reset it to true. All right, that kind of thing. All right.
We looked at the tab index yesterday. We looked at read-only yesterday. The tab stop, I've never played with that one, so I don't know. Text-align should make sense. You can center something, left, right justify it, or fully justify it. All right. Adding navigation features, again, I showed you the tab border. Do you all know what an access key is? And if you don't, what used to happen when you used any kind of Microsoft product, let's see if I've got anything open. All right. So when I go and do file, now you get this, okay? But it used to be, for example, if I wanted to exit, I could under file, there would be exit. I would have a bunch of options under there. Or I could do hold down on the Alt key and tap X for exit. That's an access key. And we'll learn how to work on and make those. They're not hard to do. All right. Yeah, it says there's another way to set the tab border. I don't know why you would do that, but all right. So they show you the property settings that are in here. This is for the example that they build. All right. Maybe we'll even build that tomorrow. I don't know. Or I'll let you walk through it and build it. How to name and save files. It says how to name the files for a project. Notice they're going back and using the old FRM. To me, what's the most important is, are you being consistent? All right. I don't want you to name buttons sometimes BTN calculate, and other times button calculate, and other times calculate button. Be consistent with the way you do it. The advantage of naming them all button or BTN is what happens is you get an alphabetic listing, and I'm going to show you that in just a couple minutes. And that's the main reason that I would want to do it, at least. All right, that's it. Okay, so again, tomorrow we will go over this one, just so you know. All right, now, you both?
I'm
okay, did yours finish? It's what? It won't download anymore. Did it give you an error?
Yeah. Try to just continue. Did you try that? Do you have any idea what we can check then? Well, just put a red thing right there, and you should be able to automatically connect.
I'm trying to install it. It was on this.
Possession, connect, and no password. Okay, you are connected. So once it comes back, we're going to come back. I will continue to manage the event. The only other thing I can think of, and I think I can hold it right there. I can see that wrong. Yeah, right mouse click on that.
Yeah.
Oh, it's not okay. Go, then move this over if you want. And, yeah, just, what is that? No, I don't know what that is. Use right mouse click on the computer. Looking for it to come up in your properties. And what I'd like to be able to do is see how much you're making out of your C drive. I don't know, C is your home drive or you know, what D is. But it may be that you're running out of room. Now, if it's a newer machine and you don't have much on it, then that shouldn't be the issue. Okay, so if you don't have much on there, then like I said, that shouldn't be the issue. Okay, red mouse becomes your C drive. Choose properties on the bottom. Now you've got plenty of room on there. Because it looks like you've got to use half of it right now. I would say give it a couple seconds. If it continues to do that, cancel out of there. Alright, if it gives you an error, just cancel it. You know, one of the options should be canceled. You might have to try to
to install it. I don't know. I, you know, again, weird stuff happens. That's all I can tell you. But I'll tell you what I will do is I'm going to go on, okay? But whatever we type in, I'll make you a hard copy so you can catch back up, okay? All right. So the other four of you are virtually here, correct? Okay. Just so we can start doing something here, okay? Once everybody's comes up, click on Create a New Project. You might have done that already. And again, we never want to use the .NET Core. We want a console app .NET framework. If that's not showing on yours, just try to type in here console app. And hopefully, notice what that shows me then near the top. But do not choose the one for .NET Core. That's the newer stuff with ASP.NET. That's not what this class is. There's, you know, why don't you want us to use that? Because it's not what we're doing. So the one I want you to choose is the one that says .NET Framework. Can you see it on here for mine? And again, always make sure you choose the one that says C Sharp on it, or C whatever, okay? Not the VB one like I've got here, all right? So I'm just going to choose this one. And once you do that, just click the button that says Next. All right, that should bring you to here. And we want to call this stop sign console, no blank spaces, stop sign console. If you're not a good speller, just do the best you can. All right. And I want to save mine. So yours, I don't know where yours will be. It could be in a lot of places. So you can either, probably the easiest way is to click the ellipsis over here. It says browse if you click on it. And I would recommend going to your desktop. If you don't want to do that, if you've got a place you like to save stuff, put it there. All right? It's not going to matter to me where you save things. All right? So I'm on my desktop here. I can tell. All right? And down here it says desktop. So I click select folder. Sometimes when you do that, it gives you an error message and you have to do it again. I don't know why. All right? Again, it's a Microsoft product. Okay? Bill Gates was here. He'd love me. All right. So notice how my location has changed. So I've got the right name, and I've got the right location. It is totally fine for what we're doing right now to have the project name and the solution name be the same. It's totally fine. If that really bugs you, then just call the project stop sign and call your solution stop sign console. You can do that too. It doesn't really matter. But since we only have one project in our solution, calling them the same thing, it's quite common that people do that. All right, so then just click Create. And it should come up then and look pretty much like this. Remember, look on the screen, please. We don't have a toolbox. We don't have a toolbox because this is not a graphic program. This is a console program, so we're not allowed to have a toolbox. All right, now, literally, I'm going to have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 lines in here that are going to say write line, and I'm going to write stuff out. Does that make sense? All right. So in order to do that, make it a little easier for me, I showed you this yesterday. I'm going to come down at the end of line 5. I'm going to add one more line that says using static, all lowercase, system.console. This is case sensitive. So I added that line right there. Can you read it okay? And again, I'll run off hard copies for everybody. All right, if nothing else, you're gonna have all Friday to play with this stuff. Okay, and we'll have hopefully the tutor here either Friday or Thursday. Again, that's just going to allow us, so instead of us down here having to write something like system.console.writeline, we'll just have to write writeline. That's all we'll have to write. All right. So to show you this, don't even type this, but right now just watch if you would. So I'm going to type in here writeline, and I noticed when I looked in here, there's about 12. I don't know. I'll go back and count them in a minute. But there's about 12 of those X's. So I'm going to put in that. And then I'm just going to type in readline. Remember, that'll stop my program.
That's all I'm going to do for right now, and I'm going to run it. Is that pretty obvious what I just did? All right. Now, you might look at that and go, well, that's really hard to read, and how am I going to move stuff over? I would like it more centered on the screen, etc. So let's talk about how you can do that. All right. The first thing is, if I want to move it down on the screen, all right, before I write this first line, I can do it as another right line. That's probably the easiest way. But I'm going to type in here right line, and in my double quotes, I'm going to put a backslash. It's right above your enter key. Backslash n, I'm going to do it about five times. So I've got about five backslash n's, and then I stopped. What did that do? It's easiest to show you. See how it moved it down? All right. The other thing I want is I want it to be more centered on the screen. If you think that's too many lines, then don't use five of them. Use two, use three. It's totally fine. All right. But what I want is I want this to be more centered on the screen. So instead of a backslash n, which means new line, which is like a carriage return line feed, I'm going to use backslash t, which is tab. So I'm going to put it about four backslash T's. And I'm going to come back and I'm going to run the program again. Now, is that pretty obvious what I just did? Okay. I'm going to have to use backslash T's for all of these if I want to try to line them up. And to be honest with you, when I try to line them up, it's probably going to look more crummy than good. I'll have to do a little bit of looking at it and playing with it, etc. All right? So, just to show you this, you don't have to do this, but just to show you this, if I copied this line that I just put in there, this line, I'm going to just come in there. It's what, 6 lines. So I'm going to put it in there 6 times. The problem I'm going to have is, well, I'll show you. It's actually, this will work. Well, that doesn't look anything like a stop sign. I think you'd all agree with that. But the point is, I've got everything I need now on here except the word stop. So now it's more or less, it's a matter of me going in and kind of tweaking this, for lack of better words. So for example, I'm going to put, instead of 4 tabs, I'm going to put 3 tabs, but I'm going to hit the space bar about 5 times. Okay? I don't know if that's right or not, but then I only want 1x, and then I'm going to put in about, 2 or 3 more tabs, and I'm going to put in another X. See what I'm doing? All right. So I'm going to save that, and I'm going to run it. Okay? Well, first of all, I shouldn't have made it the top line. I should have moved it down one. But you're getting, hopefully, the idea. All right? So let me. I don't want that to be my top line. I want it to be my second line. So now, as I go through this, okay, I can already tell I need to do some work with that, all right? Either I have to make this bigger, or I have to move this in more. It doesn't matter. I'm going to have to do one or the other, all right? So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to make this bigger. What does that mean? That means I'm going to put about 4 or 5 more of these in there. I don't know, something like that. This kind of an exercise is both good and bad. It's bad because it's like, this is sort of a waste, Jeff, isn't it? You could say that. All right, so I'm going to come in here, and I removed one of the T's. I'm going to hit 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and I'm going to add about, 4 more X's. This could be totally wrong, and that's fine. See, it's not bad now. See how I've got the first line done? I'm going to put in about 3 more to see if I can move that over. So it's a lot of, and you're not going to get a test like this. This is the only time we're going to do something that looks like this. Okay, now it looks like I have got too many. So let's take a couple of those off. Okay, all right. So now that's done. My line after that, I want it to look sort of like this. Sort of, not exactly. But sort of. So I copied that line. And now what I'm going to do is after this, instead of having 2, 3 all those tabs, I'm going to have 1 tab. I'm going to hit the space bar about 5 times. And I'm going to type in the word stop. And then I'm going to put in another tab. And run it. Do you see how it's kind kind of coming together. Does it look good? Hell no. But you get the idea, right? All right, so I'm just going to sit there and play with this, all right? And did anything else ever happen with yours? Are you still getting the errors or what? It's what? Oh, it's good, good, all right. So like I said, I'm just going to do this. And I don't, you know, again, you can say, well, you don't really even look like you know what you're doing. Who would want this for a program? All right, probably no one would buy it. But, you know, I was talking to my daughter, and I'm trying to get her back. She actually has taken web development classes. She's a very smart young lady, all right? But she doesn't have a hell of a lot of initiative. So I've been trying to get her back into IT and making some apps. And she's, I never make anything anybody would buy. There was an app that somebody made. It was a good 10 years ago. It was made for an Apple, all right, or an iOS phone. It was called Steam. You'd push a button, and it would look like your machine fogged up. You know, your phone, rather, or your tablet. Like, who the hell would buy that? The guy made $100,000 on it in the first month. So don't think there aren't fools out there that will buy almost anything. You know? They have a thing, when the San Francisco 49ers opened up their new stadium a couple years ago, when fans came in the door, they asked them, do you have a cell phone? And if they did, they had two apps. One was an iOS and one was an Android. And if you press, you know, if you load their app, it would show you where the nearest bathroom was. It would show you where the nearest concession area was, etc. Don't you think those people made a few bucks on that? So, you know, probably nobody'd ever want this. And I get that. But that said, that doesn't mean that there's not a market for a lot of this stuff.
Okay,
that's a real good question. A lot of apps are free, so how do they make any money? Because what they put out there in the App Store is free. And it's kind of like, okay, I'm going to give you this little step stool ladder with four steps on it. I'm going to give it to you for free. Okay? Yeah, but I want a big one. No, you got to pay. So what they'll do is they'll build an app that's fully functional, but is designed to do 12 things. And they'll give you for free three of those things. The one thing about, I don't know enough, I have actually developed apps for iOS, but it's been years. But one thing that they have set up for Android, if you put an app out there and you make it free, you can never change that. You cannot go back later and say, I want to charge for it. That's why that's what people do a lot, is they just put kind of a partial out there. You say, yeah, you want more? You're paying, but I'll give you more. Type of an idea. All right? So, let's see. We've got, that's almost there, the stop, but the other one, of course, has to be moved over. Yeah. Oh, and like I said, if nothing else, just try it yourselves. So, come in there. How did we do this? I'm going to start up a new Visual Studio session. Okay? So, I'm assuming you're all about here then. Okay? You might have even gone further. But create a new project. When you do, if it's showing too much stuff, then come up here. This is your search box. And type in here, console app. That should really narrow down what you're showing here. You want to choose console app, .NET, excuse me, .NET framework, and C#. Okay? So you want to click on that one right there. Then you want to click next, and you want to, we said we're going to call this one stop sign console. Now, if I try doing this, does it make sense to everybody? I'm going to get an error because I already have a file by that name. All right. So you'll type in stop sign console. You'll save it where you like to save things. All right. Sometimes what people do at the beginning of the semester is they create a folder on their desktop that's just called like C# programs. And they create subfolders in there for every program they do. If you like doing that, do that. If you don't like doing that, don't do that. All right? And the last thing I want to do is start telling you how to arrange your desktop, where you should save stuff, etc. I don't want to do that. All right? So if I do that, I'll just call it 2. So I won't have any problem. And when I click create, you'll be right where I was, which is there. And then the only thing you have to add is up here, using static system.console, semicolon. That line right there. Some people, and I can be like this, are very anal as far as everything's got to be in alphabetic order, and whatever. You can do that if you want to. You don't have to. Again, we're going to end up probably not using any of these now except this one. Maybe system. If you want to click this and remove the other ones, you can do that. I would wait until you've got the program up and running, then remove stuff that it says is unneeded. All right? So again, I'll leave this up there. Make it nice and big. That should be plenty big where everybody can see it. And I'm guessing you all get that, right? You know, and that's why I'm just playing with this, for lack of better words. That looked like it needed about one more of those. That might need another backslash T, maybe even a few spaces. Okay, well, that's way too big now, but you get the idea. This is done. That's done. I've got to bring that back. All right, so it's getting there. When you run the program, look on the screen, please. I showed you this the other day. But when you go to run the program, the easiest way to run it is to click this green button that says Start. If you don't like to do that, you can click Build, and you can tell it to not just build the solution. You can do it from here. There's another way of doing it too. I think it's hitting F5 or something like that on your function keys. That's the way I always do it. But an important thing is, when this is running like this, you can't go back and make changes in here. You are in what's called break mode because the program's running. How do you get out of break mode? Look on the screen, please. See that kind of maroon square? Just click it. Now the run stops and you're out of there. All right, that's the easiest way than what I just showed you. All right. I don't know what you mean. It might. I've never done anything with Visual Studio for the Mac. So if you say it looks different, I totally believe you. It should, if you load it 2019, it should function the same. Yeah. Like I said, notice I'm using the word should, because it should. All right, so now it's getting there. It's case sensitive in that the W in right, the L in line must be capitalized.
Yeah.
This, the stuff you put in here, if you put it lowercase, it'll just be a stop sign with lowercase X's. All right? Keywords, I mean, typically the system will find and it'll capitalize it for you the right way. If you would, just look on the screen for a second. I'm going to replace this line. And notice I'm going to type in here right line. And I'm doing it all in lowercase. When I hit space, see how it changed it? It'll try to usually do what it thinks you want to do. All right, the IntelliSense will kick in, and it will try its best, for lack of better words, to kind of work with you. All right? And will it always guess right? Of course not. But like I said, usually it'll guess right. Okay, I'll be right there.
Put a semicolon at the word console then. No, I'm just gonna go the line of that. Then I give it a preview copy. Now say it, okay, let me do that, should be there. And again, that's what's referred to as, basically it's a syntax error, you both do it as a one language. I'm not saying you did it on purpose, but I'm just saying that's what happened. Remember, you will need a read line down at the bottom of there. In parentheses, because otherwise, whatever you put on there, it's not going to show.
So, am I right, assuming at least, you all understand what I'm trying to do here? Does that make sense? All right, I'm trying to give two, is your stuff still loading?
Yeah, I think it is.
No, I mean, I know you can, I know Dominic can too. All right, but I'm just saying, I wanted to do something, for lack of better words, that you ever hear like, you go to a party and you have an icebreaker type of thing. That's kind of what this is meant to be. All right. So if you've got this one done or doggone close to it, then see if you can work on the next one. Because it's almost the same program, but you're just putting in your first initial. You could be as creative as you want to be with this. Oh, what? Well, we're going to take a break pretty quick. Now, when I get done, I'll be more than happy to print off a copy of this. That said, probably not going to help you much because you're going to have a hard time figuring out how many times you had to hit space or whatever. All right, but you'll at least be able to see what I did. And believe me, I've given assignments like this before, and I've had people who get them done a lot before I do. There are actual patterns that are in here. All right, and I'm not worrying about what the pattern is right now, but there are patterns and stuff in here that you can use. I don't know if you've ever heard this, but it is true that by and large, people, for example, who know how to play instruments or people who are math people do very well in IT. Because what is music? It's pattern matching. And that's exactly what this is. And again, when I'm doing it, if you look on the screen, I don't care if you take some creative prose and make it look even a little bit different. Again, what I'm concerned with here is, are you understanding what it is we're trying to do? If you go, yeah, good. That's what we're looking for.
So there you go. Not at all perfect, but there's my stop sign. Okay? It doesn't even look as good as the one I did here. This one, how did I do it? I used Word. All right? But it's, you know, well, you got too many of this. It doesn't matter. What I will do, so if you want, you know, this and you want to play with it, great. If you don't, that's also fine. I'm going to find mine. Where was it? The new stop sign console. There it is. I'm going to grab it. I am going to zip it. Okay. Might be because this is still open. I don't know. Oh, save everything. Yeah, and get out. All right. Okay. So there it is in zip version. And I will, right now, I haven't made an address book up for the class yet. I'll do it. I'm not worried about it. But so let's see. All right, so I just, if you look on the screen here, I just sent you mine, okay? And I called it Stop Sign Console, but I amended the name so you can open that if you want to. It's Stop Sign Console hyphen JPS, my initials, all right? What I'm most concerned with, we're going to take a break literally in about a minute, but what I'm most concerned with, there it is. Does everybody understand what we just did? Let's for now, let's skip number two, because it's kind of the same thing, and it's sort of a waste of our time. So let's take a break. Let's come back at 10 o'clock, and we're going to do number three, where we do the inches to centimeters. Everybody with me? Okay, so let's take a break. Come back at 10. Make sure you're here. I'm going to start up right at 10. All right.